So thank you for coming. Thank you, John, for the invitation. And thank you everybody who was participating in helping this project to be done, although it's not finished. We are in the middle of the rehearsing process. Today is a preview. I try to think not too much about Paris, but it's difficult. So I do my best. What we will do now, it will be separated in two parts. All these empty chairs are not a set design so that I feel better or something like this. They are there because after I finish my talk, all the people of the team from Temporary Title, who are the name are here, will join me and we will engage with you a conversation about what you have experienced, hopefully, next door. But before this, instead of talking about that project, I think it's better if you experience it and we discuss with the other after. I would like to talk about another project. As this was the invitation that I share with you other things than what you just see. So, and I decided to talk mainly about one project, which is called Retrospective. And there are several reasons to choose this work. One, obviously, is because it's also a work developed in the form of an exhibition. And I thought it is interesting to have something in regard of what you have seen, but takes another form, working on similar questions. And another reason is because maybe that's a little bit of self-promotion here, but I would love to be able to do this work with here with the people we met, this great artist and maybe other from Australia, as this work is done always with local people, and this is very important. You will understand, hopefully, through my explanation. So, that was introduction. Retrospective is a work I did for the first time in 2012 at the invitation from Laurence Racel, who was directing the Antoni Tàpies Foundation in Barcelona. The proposal she made was to make an exhibition, and that's how I started to think about this this format. And what is interesting for me, or what would be something I could do in such a place, exhibition spaces, which is not my usual place to make work. I usually make work for theater. Or some of the works, most of my works are done for the theater, not for the exhibition. And when the invitation came, I started to think about the specificity of these two places, which are the theater and the exhibition space. And if you observe what the theater can do together with the public, there are three main things that I like to remember and notice. One is that the spectator, when you go to a performance in a theater, you go at a certain time, and then the time will be organized for you. You don't decide how long it's going to be. It's going to be the time it has been decided, and the event will run in the way it has been decided. So you are not going to decide your time. You're also not going to decide your space, like today, or please feel free if you want to change seats, come a bit closer during when I talk, or a little bit further, or go. But usually it's not something we do. Huh? It's this space is like we are sitting, and it's also planned like this. It's also for good reason. But you don't choose your time, you don't choose your space. But you are part of a community, like now, that we are constructing by you listening to me talking to you, before listening to John and Lisa. And this is specific for the theater. You don't have this in the exhibition space. It's another relationship to the space, to the work, when you go to see works in these places. You obviously can choose when you go within the opening time. You also can choose how long you will stay. So the time is rather free. The space is also most of the time free. You can start by the first room, but also go downstairs, upstairs, and organize your way. So you choose your space, unless it is, of course, prescribed. But usually you can choose. The exhibition spaces are mainly addressed to individuals. You don't need to go all together. So there is not the production of a community, or not the same kind of the one we are making in the theater. So that's how the work started, by these observations. And the next step was to think about, on one side, I like very much this idea that the visitor can choose the time and the space. This is very much the idea of what I hope for each individual in the world, that you can move where you want, when you want. It's related to a certain idea of freedom, which I stand for, which is not the case in the theater. And that's a little bit of a problem and a critic I can have with this format. But what the theater does is to make this group, this community, which I think is extremely necessary in our society, because we lose, or I have the feeling I lose these opportunities. They are not easy to construct. They are not necessarily easy to participate in, or they have certain forms that are, let's say, identitarian, that I think need to be questioned. So, I'm a little bit lost, sorry. I go back to the exhibition space. Yes, exactly. This freedom of the individual in the exhibition space is something that is very, very good, I think. But we miss a little bit this sense of construction of a collective or a community. It's very much reinforcing this individualistic. So it's the confusion that maybe it's easy to make. You go as an individual in a place, but you might be pushed to be individualistic. And this border is very fragile, I think. So advantage, disadvantage, I started to think about something where the two ideas could coexist. So the sense of time and space from the theater, the sense of the production of groups and community that come from the theater, could coexist with the freedom of space and time that are produced by the exhibition space. And that's what I somehow tried to do with the retrospective. So to be a bit less general, I will try to describe retrospective. And as I am already a bit late, I will describe mainly one room. So before that, retrospective, the title, doesn't indicate that this work is a retrospective of my works, but he used retrospective as a mode of production. He used also retrospective as the fact that it is a format that is more appropriated and more specific, I think, from the world of the visual art and the exhibition spaces. And it's more difficult to think about retrospective in theater, because the theater doesn't allow to bring things together at the same time. So I thought this is something which would allow me to do something specific for this space and not for the theater. The idea of retrospective also come through the fact that every material that will be used for this work is material that come from my previous works done in the theater places, and all come from solo works. So in a way, there is this sense of retrospective of the solo work in a certain way, but the material will be transformed in order to be performed by other in the space. Retrospective is also used for the direct sense that it has, retrospective, looking backward. So it uses very much the idea of looking in the past to produce something in the present that is new. So that's why I say retrospective is used as a mode of production of something new, and not to only celebrate the past in a way. So I will describe one of the three rooms that are involved in this exhibition. And that's the first room the visitor comes in, probably the main room. In this room, I have to precise first that everything is done with people, with performers, so artists, local artists, with who I work and rehearse in a similar way we do here, but with other matters. And what we try to do is to present in this room three big categories of how works are presented usually in exhibition spaces. So the three categories are objects such as sculptures, painting, installation, everything that is in the space and doesn't move and doesn't change, with exception. We have of course in the history of art objects that have been put in exhibition space that are transformable, but I talk more on the conventions, the strongest conventions that we have. So this is one mode of presentation in exhibition spaces. Another mode is linked to mainly video art, but also music or installation. Also, I think about objects produced by Duchamp, this kinetic painting or machine that he did. And all these things that are in exhibition space are there all the time by means of repetition. So the end of the loop is the beginning, the end is the beginning. It's by means of repetition that these things are there all the time and that the visitor can come in and experience them. They will not go away. The third category, which is more recently entering the exhibition spaces, or movies, so narration, so not something like video loop, which have this idea of repeating, but literally a movie, where for me it's very often a problem when I go in exhibition spaces and I see a movie and I look at the cartel and it's written 41 minutes, 30 seconds, on the hour that I had planned to visit the exhibition, this is not gonna make it. So usually I don't see it, but more and more it's present, and that's an interesting friction, because it shows that it's a form of making something that enter a space where it is not made for. So there are transformations that are necessary, and it's interesting that we need to make this transformation. And more you will see programs in the space of the exhibition. So you know before at what time this movie will be performed or will be played, so you can go at this time, which is something. You see the slide. So basically what we do, we use these three forms and we try to perform them with the performers. And these three forms are placed in a room. If you imagine this room, this would be a perfect room to do. So a little bit small, a bit bigger. But you would have, if you imagine you enter here, you would have one person standing there, one person standing there, and two person, one on the other side and one on this side. So four person, you come in a space, four person. On one spot here, there will be a person who does what we call immobilities, which stands for all the objects, paintings, sculpture. So how to perform this it's very simple. We take images or part of the works I propose to work with, and we do a posture. So I will not be able to demonstrate. So the posture, basically, it can be a stop on the image like this. This is not part of the piece, but there is a, we literally try not to move, which is impossible for human being. So we, the performative activity in that place is to try to be immobile, which requires a lot of concentration and also produce a certain kind of relationship with the visitor coming to watch. On the other side of the space, to represent the other category of objects, things that are presented in exhibition space, we do loops of movement, which are excerpts from the solo works I propose to work with, and so it's phrase of movements that they can also involve sound, and they are performed. When it's finished, it starts again. When it's finished, it starts again. When it's finished, it starts again. So it's like you imagine a video loop, but it's a person who does this this phrase, this movement, on and on. The other so the narrative, which stands for the movie, which is something that has a beginning and an end, opposite to the other forms. Are done by the performers in a form that I call individual retrospective. What I propose to do to each one is to make an individual retrospective of my works. So each of the artists choose anything they want from the material I propose to work with. They copy, they appropriate, and they will perform this element that I have chosen, and alternatively they perform something and they walk to a visitor and speak. So it's an alternance between movement, speech, movement, speech. What is important is the movement or perform there, but the speech, if I would be in an exhibition space, I would come to you and talk like this so that you hear, but not everybody. Yeah? The narrative that is developed by each artist intertwine things from me and things from them. What they talk about is their choice, so they talk about their practices, their experience, their life, how they want. It's important that it comes from their point of view, and it's produced by what the work they have chosen do to them. It might trigger memory, it might trigger similarity, it might trigger a critic, it might trigger many things from their experience that they tell to the visitor. And they alternate telling something, doing something. And each one has a story that is tell like this. So these are the three activities that happen in the room. And two of the performers do this story. So there is one story there and one story here, an immobility there and a loop there. So this is ongoing. And of course, now that I say it like this, we have a little problem. Must this person stay there 8 hours a day? No, of course not. So there is a thing that needs to be developed for working on this question of the relationship between the theater and like the performance and the exhibition, or in another way, the subject and the object. And this is worked in a sort of a choreography that is triggered by the entering of each visitor, in order that the work is at the same time always there, like an exhibition, but also addressed to the visitor. If there is no visitor in the room, nothing's happening. They stop. When a visitor come in, there is a whole choreography that makes them go out, come in, welcome them, take the position and start to unfold. When a second visitor come in, three of them will do the same and one will stay. So one of the story will continue to be addressed to this visitor, but the three other will run away, go in, welcome the new visitor, and start the three actions. Each time it happens, the person who was there will continue there, the person who was there will continue there, the person who was there will continue there. So they will never do it, they will never stay there forever. They will only stay there for the time between two visitors coming in. But that's a system that tries to produce, to make cohabitate this form of the two form of addresses, that one is specific to the performance and one is specific to object who only need to be in a place to be experienced. So and that goes on. And as I talk already too much, or well, I had half an hour. It's okay. Yeah. Maybe I show some images about that will give example about what I mean in terms of kind of groups and community that can enter the exhibition space. I think it's more clear to look at images. So this is the first time I did the exhibition in Barcelona, Tapies Foundation. So the room can be very empty. That's when a visitor come in and obviously the performer ran out to come in later, and you have some moment in the exhibition, like in many museum in the world, where there are a few people. There probably one person somewhere, but this so this is one of the immobility that we do. But there are some other moments where you have some visitors attending this story while the other one is doing the loop. This is the same situation a little bit later. Here again, there is two person attending this person's story while you have a immobility there. Here you can see the two stories, one at the back, one in the front, and the loop there. And sometimes the space is very different because the flow of visitor change in exhibition space, and that's something that I think is very interesting in terms of temporarily there are some kind of society that forms in the space and dissolve. So that's obviously a moment where we have a lot of kids in the space. Sometimes it can also go totally out of control when the kids are there. So there was one day in Barcelona, we had every morning, it's a lot of schools visiting the museum. And one day they were so loud, they were so strong also, they started to run in the space and we had to let them do for a while. So it was quite fantastic. And sometimes it can get very, very crowded. So the place becomes more like a plaza in a village. Other kind of community. So that's a second space I didn't talk about. So I will skip this. So obviously a place for conversation and archives. This is the third room. So this is the same exhibition, but that time in Hamburg. So you see, when nobody's there, the four performers are in the middle of a room and they basically wait that someone come. That's the entrance. And then you have some situation as the front can change, each performer stage the story the way they want in the space. So it can give this kind of, like obviously a family, and you might recognize some forms later in like a group of person around someone who tells a story while the other one is lying down like an object, or a composition made out of two through the story that one say. And very interesting is how the kids go with the work. So there, one is performing the immobility. There's it's Alexandre, and the kids like very much to play these games, and they touch, want to make them move. Another, I go through. Maybe it's give an idea of the different flow of what kind of groups the work can produce. It's never the same, and it's sometimes we do sort of reproducing theaters situation, like a person talking to many in front of them, but at the same time this person seems very free to look, also check his email and things like this. There is a sense of the freedom that is associated to these spaces. Like I say, the immobility is very often a big attraction for the kids. So this one is in Rio. So this is Neto telling his story, how he started to dance by watching a clip of Michael Jackson. So he reenact a clip of Michael Jackson. Denise, a very interesting story. She started to dance when the censorship in Brazil was still at stake, and then here she demonstrated a part of this choreography, and which was censored in the 70s, and tell a whole story about that. Very, very interesting. Yeah. Again, in every country, the immobility with the kids is extremely attractive. Rio is also a place where the Museum del Mar, Museo del Mar, is a museum who works. They work a lot with schools and community. It's almost too much. There's always kids in the space, but it's also great. We had many, and it's really funny that they all dress the same. But here an example where we had two classes in the, most of the time two classes in the space. This is in Paris. Paris was not very good, but there are these moments. That's what is interesting. This moment where there are really a few visitors, and the attention is very different than in other moments where, like this, when you have more people, and you have on this picture, you see like different kind of groups around the different. This very empty space, and sometimes it produces this strange situation where people don't even notice that someone is doing something in the middle. This was in Singapore. Singapore was also a lot of visit from schools, and it was very very exciting to have this like encounter with I don't know other moments where these two women were, and then as each one brings in this is Aaron in Singapore. In their story, they also bring some things that they have done, and so you have sometimes the great moment of this kind of thing. Three person observing the sculpture, if we can say, like this, and something that happened very regularly is. Mostly with kids, but here also with other people. They simply engage in doing the same. They So you see these two women, they just follow the loop, which is taken as a which is sometimes understood as we can do the same, and they repeat so we can learn it. And that's happened very often. Here again, like a lot of like this, two different kind of audience in a way, like very visibly the school staying together, and this is very striking in Singapore. This group of people staying together, and in the front, other visitors that are there, not in the group. There is also this interesting thing that the material is recurring, is used in different exhibition and presented in very different way, and which and have very different effect according to the place and the country. And that's so in New York, in MoMA. So that's when they when they welcome the visitor. The visitor are in the middle of the room, and the two that you see will be joined by the third one and the fourth one to go towards the visitor and welcome them. When they welcome them, they go back to their position and will go start a series of different kind of group and situation. Here you see very clearly, obviously, the one jumping is presenting an excerpt of his story, while the three other are coming in to welcome the new visitor that are standing at the door. That gives a little, and the story is continue. Yeah, so you have always this very strange moment where there is sometimes no attention giving to the person who is performing the sculpture, of course, because it has less attention than somebody coming to you and talking to you. But sometimes this change, here you can see the four performing at each corner. 1, 2, 3, 4, and the visitor who at that moment are rather in the middle, in the center. Here also, the room, etc., etc. That's when the story is finished, when each one says a retrospective and finishes the story, we end the story by transforming ourselves in sculpture. So that's KJ, who is now here in blue, just finish the story and say, you can go either in that room, which is she shows that hand, or stay here. And she waits that the visitor comes in. And when the visitor comes in, she will join the other and continue the, sometimes it's very balletic. Here it was a fantastic couple who asked to learn the steps, and they spent their like really long time learning the steps with this person. Here another situation where all this attention is giving to the person who is staying immobile. It was a very beautiful moment where the people were watching this. Other way around. Here an example of how the kids very often also copy, and they feel very, very at ease, like these ones. They literally follow the performer. They learn extremely fast, and they are able to do the work after like 10 minutes or there. They feel very, very at ease. This is a typical situation which I like very much, when you have this group of people that are concentrated around this person talking, and they become without deciding it, they become a sort of a nucleus, a sort of a micro society along the story. And sometimes it turns to be more like a theater, like here when you have many people coming together. Here also the other room. And to finish, this is in Beirut. It was the last version that we did together with Scarlett in Beirut in September. So another space, but you can recognize the materials that is used. And again, the attraction by the kids who love to do the the immobility. Such was people from the camps following Scarlett, imitating, and they are also very creative and they start to compose things. It's sometimes really amazing. Okay, I think hope this was giving you an idea about that work. Also, in relationship to what you have seen, that's hopefully a way to think about how this format of an exhibition and the use of performance in this format tries to work and transform our idea of relationship between individual and community. In this work, maybe the idea of individual is of community is more like an addition of each one, where I think the proposal with temporary title is something more like the community is a sort of an organism that one has to from go out and go in. So it's a I will stop here and I will invite all my team and everyone to go to come here so we can continue with the temporary title. I usually never use pictures. First time I try, it's really horrible. I'm sorry. I don't know. I feel like it's the family Sunday evening slideshow. Yes, absolutely. Here. This good? I sit on the side.
No, you can sit.
Can I sit here? We have two microphones. Sit here. It's very impressive, no? So we have prepared nothing except what we have shown you before in the space, and I hope you could experience it. So very often I think, and I hope, the work speaks for itself, so we don't need to explain nothing, hopefully. But on the other side, hopefully this the work produce something, does something with you, to you, questions or ideas, comments. So we are very happy if you have any comments or questions to start an exchange. We have two microphones here that's where we would like to ask you to talk if you cannot talk loud enough. That would be helpful. Or does somebody of you has something to say, maybe? To start? No. Yeah. Yes, it's better for, it's more convenient so everybody can hear.
All right, first, thank you. It's really fantastic. It's a really great experience today. I was really interested in what felt like a really kind of productive tension between the apparent sort of relaxed pose of that, you know, that kind of animalistic sort of poses and movements that were taking place. That when I think about, you know, a lion, a cheetah, or whatever, in that sort of position of relaxation, I was seeing poses like that being struck, but clearly for a human being, it wasn't actually a relaxing pose. It was something that had to be really held, like, you know, when you're sort of some awful artist is trying to paint you and saying, stay still for God's sake. And so that tension between what might be relaxing to one kind of mammal and is not at all relaxing to another kind of mammal, I saw that as something that was, you know, for me was producing something that was, you know, I suppose now this is me as, you know, kind of, you know, watcher and all the rest of it, but it was really interesting watching that sort of thing happening. So I wonder if, you know, that was just like me going off on one or whether that is something that, that is sort of speaking to the experience of the performance.
I'd like to say something about that, that's one of the things I really enjoy about being in the piece. That in another piece you might try to make that effort totally disappear and become a total replica of a lion. And in this piece, everything is allowed to be visible, you know, the human side of it and the...
They joke that I never shut up. It's a really interesting kind of practice inside the... Where did you go there? Inside the work, actually, this. But it's strange how you can have... You can actually experience both things at the same time, like whole really being super specific about... So we're not trying to imitate lions. We're working with the vocabulary of lions. And lions can do things like run really fast and murder things, and clearly we can't do that. So the vocabulary we're working with is limited to the things that humans can reasonably produce. So there is definitely tension and discomfort, but there's also this sense of time in the work that permits you to stay there, and you actually go through cycles of comfort and discomfort, or your mind goes somewhere else and you're not thinking about that. So it's a really, that tension is a really interesting, it's keeping us all awake and present somehow also.
Another thought on that, because we've looked at video of lions. So when I'm doing those relaxing poses, I'm also thinking of the sense of smell and hearing, so it doesn't stay limited to just a sight. Mm. So you might be in a position that looks relaxed, but there's this sensory awareness that goes out to where others are or the space itself, which is a different type of awareness in that state, other than being completely relaxed or completely ready for action, somewhere in between.
It also brings my attention within it and also sitting outside at the work to, I guess, this idea. A lot of people sort of look at various kinds of art, and one of their initial judgments of it is the work. You know, I want to see work. I want to see effort going into something. And I find that really interesting, that it is it's apparent. There's a doing. It brings your attention to it very directly. This idea of art making or the production of art as effort. As you know, is it actually effort, or are we putting more effort than is necessary? Are we not putting enough effort into it? These kind of questions.
It is interesting that apparently it does this on you too. Huh? So it's very kinesthetic or something. that is shared in a way, their experience. It's not the same, but there is something in you of that question. Do I perform, I'm lazy, or am I lazy?
A rather formal situation coming up to a mic. I actually probably am loud enough not to use this, but I will use the mic. I had a beautiful conversation with Scarlett. We talked about love, the difference between nakedness, nudity. We also talked about formats within visual art, such as landscape, self-portrait. And I just wondered, all of you have had so many conversations this afternoon, and what are the most memorable parts of those? And actually, where do you file them? What are you going to do with them?
Hello. Yeah. Oh, what was I going to say? I've now, in the thing of looking for the microphone, lost myself. Yes, where do you file them? Actually, I wasn't answering that. I was answering the part before, which was, I don't remember exactly, but what I was going to talk about was how one conversation informs very much the next conversation, even if you've prompted the conversation with another question, which is different to the prior conversation, if I make any sense in saying that somehow it's this like ever accumulating conversation for me anyway, that like somehow I have one conversation, then I go to the next person and perhaps I haven't quite finished the other one yet, and I ask a different question and we enter into a conversation about something, and somehow we end up back dealing with some similar content to the prior conversation, and also this could be because of the nature of the questions that they are sort of, and they're sort of like bound together by what's happening in front of you, and in a way, and yeah, but I don't plan to keep the conversation, like document them or anything like that. It's just they lead to another, that they inform something other for me.
In the same way as in the work, how where the conversations will take themselves, I mean, we have sort of questions that we can start them with, but they definitely for me have gone to very, very different realms, and beyond the work as well. Sometimes I found myself thinking, like talking to a friend or something. I've gone, it's made a connection with the stranger I was speaking to in the work in a real life, definitely situation. So I don't file them, but that you encounter them like you encounter them in the work. It's pretty strange to have such a, I mean, I've had many very like in-depth and touching and very important conversations for me in the work, and then they come back in real life, definitely.
Today I was in one conversation that ended up in this amazing kind of free consultation with the doctor about vitamin D. And like how much was good and sunscreen versus, like it was really super useful. So that was a whole new realm. I was very excited about that. So I'm going to try really hard not to be like, hi, I'm Becky. Are you a doctor? Can I ask you a question?
For me, some of the most memorable moments in the conversations is actually the approach, and also the leaving as well. Like the joy of connecting even before your eyes meet, like when you feel that somebody has registered you, and then also the sadness of also leaving that connection, sometimes prematurely or sometimes when it's run its course as well. And that there's sometimes it's not about the content, but it really is about the beginning and the end and the privilege of being able to actually connect with people. And also, like, how much of a shame it is that it takes something like this to also connect with strangers sometimes as well.
I'm quite curious about, like, I think what the first question was about, let's say, about effort or the tension of seeing the physicality that is not natural to our bodies being enacted by the human body. And I wondered about whether, for those of you that engaged in conversations today, whether you noticed the effort in the conversation. Because it is the part of the score, I think, that maybe appears the most effortless. And it is probably also, for me, where I'm working the hardest. Because I'm with you when I'm speaking to you, for sure. I'm really there. But I'm also navigating the it's not only about having a conversation. It's also ways in which to unfold. I'm unfolding things. We are, I don't know who I'm speaking for. Sometimes we have to speak as we, and sometimes we have to speak as I. Like, this is a game that we play. So sometimes I'm never quite sure whether I'm a we or an I, or so I just had a moment there of like, just wondered, yeah, how did you experience the effort of conversation?
There's so many things that are unfolding out of this, you know, as you say, that one conversation leads into another one. What I was interested in, if I can get my thoughts into one place, is, you know, we make a distinction. When we walk down the street, we don't speak to strangers. We don't walk up to strangers and say, "What do you think about love?" But if we see a dog, we will go, "Oh," and we'll have this incredible intimacy immediately with an animal. And so one of the things that I was thinking before was how much this transition between the embodied animal and moving back into the conversation, there's a kind of an infection that takes place. And what it feels to me, in my experience of it, is that if we're really embodied, then the place that we go when we have a conversation is somewhere beyond our normal thinking. You know, it's what could be called body-mind thinking. And this might be taking us into somewhere we don't want to go, but I was interested to know whether conceiving this work, Scarlett and Zeria, whether there was a kind of interspecies animal studies kind of question behind it, or whether, you know, at a philosophical level, I guess, what is this, maybe this is a question for us all, so what's this work saying to us about our relationship with animals, and what can that give us? How can that change the way we relate to each other?
Is it a question? Sorry, I thought it was much more a thought that you share. Is it a question?
Is that part of your concern, this kind of what we can learn?
Well, I can try to say something. Is there are questions to our relationship to other things and animal being one, not specifically, and the work is not conducted by a very deep thought on, how did you say this again? The interspecies, yeah. No, I recognize the term, but it's as we work in trying to embody different things that would not be human, we work on this relationship to these other things, and hopefully propose you also to think and in a way experience this relationship by trying to undo our habits of looking to, like you say, it was a very good example of animals, like we look to animals and or other thing, the way we look at them when these things are actually performed by human, where we are actually supposed to look at human, but we cannot look at human because they don't look like human, but they are really human. So that's what the work in the inter thing more than species, but I guess you can absolutely apply it to this specifically to relationship to animals.
Yeah, I follow very much, and I think the work does examine a lot of relations. Be it your relations to the person sitting next to you, be it the things that you are looking at, the conversations that you can hear, and when you talk about the level of intimacy, which is things that you approach to, I think it was a lot for me today. I have a conversation with you on falling in love. One of these questions is like how is falling in or out of love for you? So immediately this question is a lot about like connecting with a relationship with another person, loved as relations. But this is interesting, there's a person also go towards the relationship with objects. So this big scale of being or form that I guess pass through in this landscape that we are creating. It's interesting when you talk about this intersex, because it does cross. There is a cross. They are not a layer that one on top another, but it's interesting that they create this dynamic of crossing and go through by encountering or meeting, departing, and this crossing perhaps create an area that is gray area that for one to contemplate, where you're contemplating. That's why I thought it's more a thought. It is interesting that you talk about it, because it makes me think. So thank you.
The last two questions. If not, it's very frustrating.
Thanks for the work. I've got a few thoughts going on, so I'll see how they might unfold. I was really fascinated by how the work perhaps plays with the shifts between individual and three types of collective. There seems to be the collective of those of you who are there in the work, otherwise naked. There is the collectivity of those of us who have entered into the work, who might be those who are clothed. And there's the third collectivity of what happens between us, which probably happens most when you disaggregate, that is when the naked of you disaggregate and form this, certainly the acoustic space shifts, and we become part of this different kind of collective. And I'm curious about this role of title, temporary title, but also the title that perhaps enables the work to take place. Xavier, you mentioned the conditions of exhibition in relationship to theatre, and this playing off the kinds of socialisation which we bring into that space. There's a different kind of socialisation or languaging going on amongst the performers. So there's maybe two questions out of that. I'm interested in the performers as to what you notice of the kind of individual and collective relation going on between those entering into the room, the space with you. And my second kind of curiosity is around the collective third space which we're all in, which is this working with the conventions of exhibition, and what it is to play with those conventions and the possibilities perhaps beyond that form of convention, or what it would be to displace the title of the exhibition space into other kinds of space, not theatre, not exhibition, convention, and what might open up in the different collectivities that might be at play between us then. Maybe the first question.
I kind of feel that your question is also summing up for me. It's almost like a summary, I feel, for me personally, from the questions that have been asked as well. And the words identity pop up, as well as learning. And I refer to that in regards to the collectives that you're referring to, but I think I'm also going back to the question of the archiving or filing of the conversations, as well as Nikki's, I think, embodiment, which is what the first question about being comfortable or uncomfortable in a line position. I feel that for me, it's very much about learning about the work through the situations that I find myself in. And the conversations I find really difficult, not generally. So for me, it has been quite a challenge to go into the conversations. And I have to say that sometimes perhaps I even try and avoid that area of conversation. And I find myself like kind of just saved a lot of the time. But what I'm trying to get to in regards to what you were saying is that it's all really been about learning. And I kind of find that once I go, okay, I've got this bit, I've got what I've got, how I've got to get into the conversation or how to go about the conversation, then something new comes in. And that I've been learning that it's the collective that keeps teaching me that. So whether it's the collective as a group that I go, oh, okay, the group is here now, so I've got to kind of go with this rather than being set in my ways. So for me, it's been definitely about learning to break a lot of habits within the different collectives that are there.
I think one of the beautiful things that I'm hearing is the word questions. And from my experience of being in this process and then also being a witness on the outside, is that lots of questions are coming up for me about existing within the practice, and then about engaging with an audience. And that also comes up for me when I have been on the outside of the, like, a closed spectator or audience member or whatever it is, I don't know. I've got a question about that. And I think that on a daily basis, I am surprised by the situations that I find myself in. So, like, we have a particular situation that's been set up, and our job is to engage with the choreographic situation and to make sure that happens. But within that, we have the license to kind of make decisions. So there's always these choices that we're making as performers in the work. And today, I got surprised because I was engaging in a conversation with somebody and somebody else turned around and asked me to be quiet. And I was shocked. And I thought that was like a really beautiful and unexpected moment where I was in this process of, yeah, what I thought was, you know, understood and an audience or a visitor got really offended, you know, it was quite offended. They were quite offended. Or like, it was a little bit aggressive. And I kind of had to make a decision on how to respond in that situation. And I just like, was like, looked and was like, okay, lowered my voice a little bit. But yeah, I guess like one of the, I don't know if I'm answering your question, but one of the things that I'm also being in this learning and questioning and, you know, that maybe even though we set up these situations where the audience feels like they can walk around and stuff, that there still is these conventions that people come in and expectations that people come in with. And I think that it's nice that there's a whole heap of different scenarios that could possibly play out and you never know which is going to happen. So yeah, I think it's an exciting space to be working in, like with this idea of breaking down the binary between audience and performer, but that people will still come in with that as a like an idea of how things should occur in the space. And yeah, I find it exciting.
Yeah, well, this binary was of course today very present as you came. It's, you know, it's 2 hours. You came at 2, the beginning, or you come 15 minutes before the keynote starts, or something like this. So definitely this relationship, or not yet. I mean, at work in a way that they can be at work in another setup when we'll do it. But there was one thing, maybe as a, I don't know if this can be an element to of answer to your question. There is this one moment where we all go engage conversation with the visitors, so the space becomes noisy and there's nothing in the middle. I noticed that I think all the visitors, or most of the visitors who were not involved in the conversation with one of the performer, started to have a conversation with the person they came with. And in a way that looked very different than what you would do in a theater, because it's really boring. And so there is like not this, or it's very exciting. Look at not this. It's another way, and also different than what you would have in an exhibition space, because normally, or usually, if you engage, you stand in front of the work and you say like, but here obviously the work is not there or is all around. So there was I would be curious what people were saying, of course, but already in how they spoke. And I think this a moment where the collective is of another kind, I would say, as one of the possible byproduct. So that was obviously too many answers for the one question, which should have been 2, but thank you.
Please join me in thanking Xavier Scarlett and the 18 artists of Temporary Title 215.